folks. Good evening and welcome to the Scituate Board of Selectmen's meeting. It is 7:05. And tonight we're starting our agenda with the first agenda item, which is calling the meeting to order. At this time, I'd like to have an acceptance of the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Mr. Harris, seconded by Mr. Vignani. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous. Okay. Moving on to the same next agenda item, which is walk-ins. Are there any walk-ins this evening? Seeing none, we'll move on to the third agenda item, which is a discussion vote of a sewer betterment, Rosas Lane. And Mr. Bangert, good evening.
Thank you.
And welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm pleased to report that the sewer of Rosas Lane, Carnsley Lane, and Newfield Road has been completed. All the bills have been paid and assembled, and the project was completed for $492,000, which is less than the $527,000 projected. So that $35,000 in savings is then applied into the betterment that will be assessed at the result of this meeting's action to the recipients of the sewering. The original estimate for the betterment per household was $19,000. This final assessment is $17,636, savings of about $1,260 per family as a result of being able to do the project for less than we had projected originally. So this requests that you take a vote ordering the assessment of betterments and the privilege fees to collect the expenses incurred by the town, and then that starts the process for the treasurer collector and the assessor to move forward with the associated billing steps.
Questions from the board? Mr. Norton?
Just one. This is for the most part the same as Third Cliff, Second Cliff, Greenbush. Same process, same.
Yes, we had the same requirements of needing to completely resurface the road and put in the same equipment and the same pipelines that we put in the other areas. The betterment is a little bit less by chance.
Yep. Yeah, but it's the same process. Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
Other questions from the board?
Just Al, so it's up and operational and everything's?
Yes.
Yep. Everything is?
I don't know if every homeowner has connected yet, but the majority of the homeowners have connected, and it's pumping away.
And that's what it's their job to get the actual final hookup?
Yes, it's their job to get from the
house
place in the cellar out to the
street
sewer system. Yep.
Questions from the audience? Mr. Harris, you had a question.
Take Joe first.
No, just make a motion.
Oh, all right. It's just a comment, that's all. Al, I can't thank you enough. The residents have been waiting since the 60s for this to happen, and thank you for a very, as fast as it could go, and it looked to me, talking to the residents, that very professional, and everyone seems to be very happy. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll pass that along to the crews as well.
Yes. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. I mean, Al, you brought this forward 2 years ago. You're saying you're trying to expand the sewer distribution. You did, and wonderful job, under budget, phenomenal. So kudos to you, people in the DPW sewer department, phenomenal job, well done.
I'll pass it on to them. Thank you.
Mr. Norton.
Motion.
Please.
The total cost of the project of $491,625 is hereby determined, of which 97.4 is hereby assessed as a betterment and 2.7 as a privilege fee upon the parcels in the Rosas Lane sewer project area, being those who benefit from the project. The cost to be assessed per sewer unit as a betterment $17,736.60 under Section 15 of the Chapter 83 of the General Laws. The cost to be assessed as a privilege fee is $12,736.60 under Section 17 of Chapter 83 of the General Laws.
Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Harris. Further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Unanimous. Al, thank you.
There's a second part to this motion, I guess. I'll read that also. We can probably vote. A set amount is hereby certified to the Board of Assessors to be committed to the tax collector pursuant to Section 4 of Chapter 80 of the General Laws.
Is there a second on that motion? Second by Mr. Harris. Further discussion?
Does Jane have any?
Jane, do you?
No.
Mr. Vignani was asking a question, I think, concerning our motion about the amount, this is concerning the Rosas Lane betterment, and Mr. Norton said that said amount is hereby certified to the Board Assessors, be committed to the tax collector pursuant to Section 4 of the Chapter 80 of the General Laws. Do you have any observations or concerns or worries? You're not the...
I don't know if you want me to explain what the process is next.
We don't need it.
Once it's committed to Al, I mean, once it's committed from the Board of Selectmen to the Board of Assessors, then the assessors and I time it so the people can feel, and they have a 30-day clock to pay the full principal amount without any accrued interest. And then after that's done, for those that don't pay for it, we put a lien on their property, and then it will be included in their future bills for the next 20 years, I assume you vote.
Yep.
Yes.
4%.
Perfect.
Thank you.
So 30 days to pay it in full, otherwise it's amortized over 20 years at 4% interest.
Right.
Awesome.
Thank you, Jen. Any further questions? All in favor?
Aye.
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 Unanimous. Al, thank you very much. Al, actually, I think that's it for you this evening, right?
Yep.
You're not coming back for anything else, right? I just want to say thank you and the DPW and the other people for what you did on Chip Shape Day. Phenomenal job. We're going to talk about other business.
Thank
but I just
you.
Want to
many
say
residents who came
job.
Out to clean up our town and make it look very nice. And we're all very proud of that fact.
Do you have any stats on it? How many bags or how much?
About 1,000 bags were distributed. About 40% of those were for recycle and 60% were for trash. Judging by what we see in the community and by the load that's being placed in the transfer station, this is coming in, all 1,000 of those bags, plus numerous tires, sticks of wood, and other assorted items that have been discarded over the years have been accumulated. So we'll have at some point a total tonnage available, but right now it was probably double the turnout from last year.
Mr. Harris?
I was just going to say, I thought it was, you know, a window on Saturday that people would be out there. Sunday when I was driving around, I saw people still out there.
Yeah.
It was incredible.
It was so much fun, people came back to get more bags.
Thank you.
Now, who ended up picking them up? Did DPW go around? Because they were all lined along the street.
Right. The instructions were to leave them out where the DPW could see them, and they'll be in the course of the week, we'll be picking them up. Undoubtedly, there'll be some that are tucked behind somewhere that we didn't see the most. So if people see bags and want to drag them out nearer to the street, obviously not blocking traffic, then the public works folks will pick them up in their rounds.
Great job. Thank you very much.
Pass that along to that committee.
And also the Committee for Beautification, too. Thank you. Moving on to agenda item number 4, it's a discussion vote, special events permit for the 375th Anniversary Celebration Committee. Mr. Cavell, good evening. Mr. Litchfield, good evening. Welcome, gentlemen, again.
Thank you.
All right. So we're back again talking about 4th of July, and I also see there's been some other things submitted. What I really like, too, and I said this the last time we were here last week, is the town is using the logo, which is, now it's in color, which I even like better, on our letterhead. So I have to say that's phenomenal. We need to really continue to press the logo and the issue. Anyway, I just want to at least say to you, that's phenomenal. So let's address the first issue, which is the 4th of July engagement for Monday. At the town or the Cole Parkway. Since last time we were here, there were some concerns that the board had raised about parking, number one, I think, well, I say not in this order, but parking, closing down a portion of Cole Parkway for the event. I think there was a few things that were going to be going on between a band, a drill team, and cutter coming in different locations, and the board was concerned about whether or not you had enough input from various departments here in town. I see in preparation for tonight's meeting we have had some input. There have been some concerns. Police have indicated that no parking signs, sawhorses need to be put up to be able to kind of cordon off that section. The fire said it was okay. The DPW said it was okay. The building department said that if you're going to be putting up any tents, you're going to be needing a permit for that. And and for the stage. Health Department said it was okay, and the Recreation Department said okay. Bandstand is available for those dates, so the bandstand's certainly open. The Harbor Master did raise some issues. Have you had an opportunity to speak with the Harbor Master?
I have.
Okay, and the issues he raised with the board was that where are the boaters going to park? As I've indicated the last time, that's not a concern to me, but I know it's a concern to some of the other board members here. Some will leave their boats on Thursday or Friday for a long weekend. How will the boaters be notified? Is there a Water Department element? There was talk of a Coast Guard vessel. That was a concern for the Harbor Master. Could they use just the southern half of Cole Parkway as opposed to the section that you're looking on the eastern portion? How long will Cole Parkway be closed? And then they're also concerned of the impact of 5,000 people extra on the 4th of July. Is this a one-shot deal? Is this an annual? So, having said that, what do you have to inform us with respect to Cole Parkway and having hopefully ironed out issues?
I think it's ironed out as far as the Harbor Master's concerns were.
Excuse me.
The latest page that I brought you tonight is, again, the satellite view of the parking lot, and we have outlined and hash-marked the area that we will close off, that we propose to close off, I guess I should say. You'll see that it encompasses the bandstand. We'll move the stage south, which is toward the bottom of the page, from the bandstand near the anchor, which is the little white specks in the middle of the grass there. It's 8x16 stage, so it'll fit in there very easily. We need to also place the crane that will hoist the Franny Litchfield humongous flag, and that could conceivably go on the other side of the anchor on the grass. By freeing up the parking to the north of the bandstand, as that line indicates, there is adequate parking, in the opinion of the Harbor Master, at least, for the boaters, and then the most southern end will also be freed for their use. His concern about how we'll notify them, he believes that if we put a poster up in his office and also out at the top of the ramp that indicates this area is going to be closed from 7 o'clock in the morning on the 4th, Monday the 4th, until 2 o'clock in the afternoon, which gives us time to remove any folding chairs that we bring in, that would be adequate notice. I told him we'd also see if we could get a piece in the Mariner that says for 2 weeks in advance there's going to be a shutdown of part of the parking, and I don't know if they can reproduce this or not. But we will work with him and do whatever additional seems to be necessary to get the word out, and he seems content with that. The water connection, I didn't understand that one. I didn't know that was an issue.
Is there a water-dependent element? In other words, whether you needed water for some aspect of it? I assume no.
No.
Okay. You didn't need it last year, so that's why my assumption was that you didn't need it.
His concern with water has to do with the usage of the lavatories in the Harbor Master building, frankly. And I told him that we would put a pair of porta-potties at the southern end to supplement his, because he will undoubtedly have some people come in.
Sure. Okay.
The issue of the Coast Guard cutter, I proposed to him today that we have a good solution for it. The 47-foot Coast Guard cutter can park in the slip of Big Pebble over at the Maritime Center, which is a 56-foot post, who's going away for the week from the 2nd of July to the 8th. Dick Clements, who owns it, has cast his approval, and Brian Carreri, who runs the boat works, has agreed. In fact, he is enthused about it. It means using the dock right beside the travel lift at the Marine Center. It's the first spot on the dock, so it's excellent access for the public. There is parking there in the summer when the boats are in the water. We may have to schedule a school bus to run out there because there is limited parking. I think we can also invite the launch service to run a shuttle if he'd so like, and he gets to keep what he eats or kill what he eats or something, I don't know. I have suggested to Howie Kreutzberg that this would be a good opportunity for a lot of our community to see the Maritime Center for the first time and for the Boat Works to be there and talk to the people who are coming in and probably pick up business. At the same time, if we can get people that far, I'm going to talk to NOAA and see if they can get their research vessel staffed for the day and open it up for tours down on their dock. People can walk down there and then come back for the bus ride back to Front Street.
Be nice.
And that way, if the cutter gets pulled out on a search and rescue, we've still got the research vessel, so there's a good backup there.
Two questions he also raised was, how long will Cole Parkway be closed?
7 a.m. to 2.
Okay.
However, it will be posted in the parking area at least days before what's going to be closed down.
Okay.
And the posters will be up for a lot longer than that.
And the last question was, is this a one-shot deal or annual? What's the?
But certainly not annual. I answered that to him by saying it's really once every 25 years when we celebrate the anniversaries of the town. But I also said that at the moment, at least, we're on a plan of moving through the services. We had the Army there last year. We're having the Coast Guard this year. There is a Navy, and we might come up with a Navy. I have to be careful saying that. There's more Navy men here than there are Army. We may have a Navy event if we can get something put together on it in the future. But it doesn't necessarily have to be there.
Mr. Harris.
You may be nervous when you said Cole Parker would be closed down. According to this, it's just about a third or 40%, just the waterfront. But the other part will remain open to come, first serve people. Okay, good. You don't
Front
need the
Street
whole thing.
Front Street will not be bothered at all.
No, but even looking at this, it looks like 40% of the parking lot is going to be taken up by the event.
More than 4%.
40.
Oh, 40.
40,
yeah.
Yes, right.
Mr. Harris.
Nope, that's it.
Mr. Harris? I'm sorry, Mr. Norton.
just one question. We have people, I think this is great, but where people will possibly be coming in on a Friday and going out for the weekend, or planning on staying for the weekend, what will you do with cars that are there Monday morning?
Chief Stewart has indicated that we can move them over to another parking spot. We're really very against moving cars.
Yeah, but you see what I'm saying?
I do.
Yeah.
I would hope we're able to get people well enough informed that they won't want their car to be in the middle of a crowd of people where it's going to get scratched.
We have almost 2 months, and
well,
I would
they'd be towed. They'd be towed, right?
Well,
if
that's what, I guess what I'm asking.
We hope not. We don't.
Right, but if we don't want to, but if they are, I mean, that's the question.
Chief Stewart's idea is we don't tow them away. We tow them to an open spot.
Right. Right.
Okay.
Thank you.
We don't
want to. I know. That's my question.
Right. Right.
Thank you.
Mr. Vignani.
Yeah. Have you spoken to St. Mary's about having that lot available?
We have not yet.
Okay. And then I don't know if we need some sort of shuttle capabilities, or if you actually had to tow somebody, you could maybe go to the MBTA.
Yes, well, we're planning to use the MBTA and run school buses.
Right.
The other thing is, there's a car maybe on the back row, probably just leave it there.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, it's going to be a lot of people standing up because we don't have bleachers or anything.
Right.
So, you know, if there's a couple cars in, they're not really in the way, they're just there.
Well, let's just say, if you don't plan on enforcing it, then people are just going to park there.
That's
so
right.
You have to let them know that if they do park in that area, their car will be towed.
Good point.
One thing I noticed is that Mr. Patterson has submitted to us a hashed area that is different than yours, and that being that the parking directly next to the Harbor Master that you're looking to try to annex It would be, if you look at yours, Ed, okay, there's two sets of parking directly in front of the Harbor Masters, and
right.
then there's another two, basically they're perpendicular to, or you know, parallel to
if
each other.
If he submitted one to you that's different than this,
yes.
you'll notice it's his signature on the bottom of the mine.
Unless this is this yours? I'm sorry.
That's
we're looking at this one.
They all look the same
yeah.
from this distance.
Where'd you get that? Oh,
this is.
Page
did you see the difference? I just want to make sure that we're on the same page.
Yeah, that looks like it.
Steve, is that it right there? Okay, so you're on there. Okay. The one that was submitted to us had the entire area going north to south annexed as opposed to what has been agreed upon. So yours is changed. It's not really a third. It's actually
much smaller, huh?
Probably maybe a quarter, if that, or a fifth
Six,
of the parking lot.
Yeah.
So, okay.
I think you'll see a difference in his versus mine, where I have negotiated the northern boundary to include more than it than his did, and I gave up the southern piece down here because of that.
Yeah. Okay. So that's what we're talking about. Okay. Good.
So it's about 75 spots. It looks like.
That's correct.
Did I hear you say when you were reading the thing that we would need a building permit for our stage?
That's what
Neil said. Did you need one last year?
No, I mean, it just sits on the
I think
ground.
It said for
it's
a tent.
It's just a bunch of decks.
Just talk to Neil, Steve,
yeah,
just
I'll
to be on the safe side. I suppose Neil would probably want to make sure that it's
safe.
Up to code, yeah. just to, you know, not that it's not. It was. I was standing on it last year. It was fine. The general was standing on it last year.
And
two generals were standing on it.
And
know?
They will again this year.
So so I just want
to
just double check with Neil. Okay. Other questions from the board?
No, good luck with it.
I know. Yeah.
I think that's it for the 4th. I know that you've given us at least a calendar of events for the band concert, which is great. And I know that you've been meeting regularly. Well, this was looking for dates for the May, June, July, August.
Yes, there's a lot more than band concerts in there.
Or the bandstands, what I'm saying. That primarily that seems to be it, but there's the Lighthouse Commemorative Dinner. You've got Scituate through the past darkly, Heritage Days,
Cape
Cod Canal Cruise, the commemorative Don't Give Up,
Don't Give Up the Ship,
which I know is the Commodore, if I'm not mistaken, from the Constitution's coming down, Mr. Brown?
Yes.
And I think you're also doing a, this month, the photo exhibit at the GAR on Life Magazine. That's the May 12th. Through the 20th. I guess it's longer. I apologize.
It's always the 28th.
And as well as Tales of Old Scituate on May 27th.
We also have another
excuse me.
Half a dozen events that have been identified. They not necessarily have dates assigned to them yet, so I didn't include them. But there's a pretty good number of events happening during the course of the year.
I think the second or third week in June, I forget which, the Historic Society is going to have a sort of an opening of the Bates House.
Right.
Good.
Which will be kind of neat.
Reenactment, maybe?
I think it's just going to be kind of torn and through.
Fair enough. Good. I think what would be nice is to have maybe the committee come back again at the end of the month. I assume by then everything will be pretty much finalized, set in stone. Maybe, maybe not. I don't
the
know what your thoughts
be.
Are. The fourth one. But I'm saying just generally for your events.
Yeah.
I think that's phenomenal.
Seems to be gelling as time goes on.
Looking forward to Don't Give Up the Ship. That's going to be a very fun event.
It is.
Yeah. So, Mr. Vignani.
Ed, what is the time frame of the 4th, the activities on the 4th? Is that like 11 to 2, 11 to 1 or?
It's 10 to noon.
10 to 12, okay. And then the prep and the takedown.
Well, the cutter will be open probably later.
Oh, right. The cutter is the afternoon.
I'm talking the actual festivities at the bandstand and on
speeches
the,
and the
right,
last
speeches. Okay.
Gentlemen, I thank you very much. Certainly the American Legion, also the members of the committee. Matt Brown, I want to thank you very much. I know you've been instrumental and certainly with the logo and certainly the research with the USSS, I'm sorry, the USS Chesapeake, and Don't Give Up the Ship. And that's going to be very exciting. It's great for the town. I know that you sent out, I think, on Thursday, basically the location of the unfortunate battle that the Chesapeake ended up losing and being taken by, I think, the HMS Shannon. Yeah, and it's funny, as a result of looking at that, I ended up doing some research, finding that the Chesapeake is now a mill in England and a town.
It's a great thing on the internet, I found that the other day.
Which would be neat to see if we could get a piece of that. They carve it out of the beams in their building, but I have to say it's phenomenal to find out that it was only off of Boston Light, not far, that you could see from the Scituate shore.
You could. In addition to what Ed talked about, we've come up with a whole bunch of t-shirts that will be on sale in the harbor and in Scituate. We have a banner that will be spread through with each event, and I'm giving a talk on the 27th, in which the proceeds will go to fund the events, and so we're doing pretty well. And you'll be getting invitations, many people in this room will be getting invitations to the Don't Give Up the Ship reception that'll be held at the Maritime Center on June 1st, the 199th day since the Chesapeake met the Shannon offshore.
Zach, did you catch that?
Yeah.
Did we get that? Good. Matt, thank you.
And I would hope in the future that Scituate, that we would continue this Don't Give Up the Ship idea. The fact that Scituate is the home of the motto of the United States Navy. And I think that we should be known as that.
Then we get the Navy guys here for the next
That'll
Legion
be the
thing.
Navy guys.
I have to tell you, I'm completely in, as the board is, supportive of it. And I think it's a phenomenal, and you know, a lot of people always attribute it to the Lake Erie battle, but it actually originated here right off our shore. So that's good. So thank you, gentlemen. Good. Thank you very much, Ed. Yep. Thank you, Steve. And look forward to seeing you shortly in the next few weeks.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Have a good evening. And again, thank you. Folks, moving on to the next agenda item.
Thank you. I'll send you this stuff. Your email.
Yep. We will move on to agenda item number 5. And that is a discussion, a vote of the sewer betterment deferral request number 11-1. And just for the edification of the board, there is a request by number 11-1, which is it's a confidential request by a property owner seeking an exemption of sewer betterment that everybody's entitled to request to the Board of Sewer Commissioners, which happen to be the Board of Selectmen. And these individuals are seeking a form of deferral of paying the sewer betterment from where they live, and this does not have anything to do with the issue that we dealt with agenda item number 3. So I asked the board how do they feel on this request. We've had an opportunity to review it. Due to the confidentiality of the request, we don't disclose anything to the public as to the people who are requesting it, as to the reasons, because it's financial concerns. So, in any event, I want to make sure that people understand that. But having said that, are there any questions or observations from any of the board members, or is there a motion? Mr. Vignani.
A couple of comments. the Board of Assessors obviously looked at this before us, and they denied the application. So now it's come before us as the commissioners. My fear with this is that you know, you set a precedent if all of a sudden you defer this, and then you'll have everybody coming in to defer it, and then it really just passes the cost along to a few as opposed to many of the people that are getting the benefit of it. So I would be reluctant to support this, given the fact that the benefit is there and the precedent that we would set for ongoing, you know, we're sewering a large part of the town now, and I think if we start doing this, that we'll get quite a number of these applications done, and then the fees won't be dispersed properly amongst all the people that get the benefit.
Mr. Norton.
Just a follow-up comment. Certainly wish there was something we could do here, but with the Board of Assessors denying this, as Tony said, for the reasons that he listed, and the only alternative I could think of, and it's not necessarily a good alternative, is to lower the amount over a longer period of time or something like that. take 25% off for 50, you know, but that's just a, again, that wouldn't, certainly wouldn't solve their problem, I don't think. And it would not address the, what Tony brought up about other people coming forward. You know, I think we probably sued probably 500 homes in the last 5 years. And that could really open up the Pandora's box, which concerns me.
Mr. Harris.
What would this do to the other people? Would it have any effect on what they have to pay if we did a number of these? By deferring it, we're just pushing it off for the people. It's recorded as a lien on the house, isn't it, Tricia?
Yeah, it is.
All right, so it's not necessarily going to cost any of the neighbors more money if a number of these were deferred. Okay, and we did it last year, and this is something we'd have to do every year?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yes.
All right. And by doing it tonight, let's say if we were in favor and we did it tonight, it pushes their whole 20-year loan off another year, correct?
With interest.
Right, 8 or 9% interest. But it's just deferring. Right, 1 year. All right.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Mr. Nunn.
Again, and it's, I know the probably the best way to handle this is what Tony suggested. I wonder if, since it is going to come back every year, whether the board could entertain the idea of giving it a deferment for a year with the strong statement that it wouldn't be available next year. And if there's something that's causing it this year here, that the situation might better itself by next year. That'd be my only suggestion.
Well, two options that you mentioned, which I think are plausible. Well, three, actually. It's the ultimate denial. The other option is to defer it, as we did with a notice that next year we're not inclined to do so. Or a third option is to reduce the amount for this year, making them pay an amount, not the amount that's requested or demanded, rather, but knowing that whatever's not paid, what's unpaid is compounding and accruing, and in the event that the property's sold, it's all paid off at once. So in other words, so that everybody understands that what's due the town will be paid with interest. So three options, I think two of which you've articulated. And I'm certainly open to all three, whatever the board would like to do.
Well, let me try a motion, see if it passes. Move that we defer this for the period of 1 year with the understanding that the board will not look favorably upon future appointments.
Motion by Mr. Norton. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Vignani. Further discussion?
Just one quick question. Just so I make sure I understand the data, are we deferring? It looks like it may be more than 1 year.
Well, they haven't paid for those subsequent years. You see the carry-forward balance.
Right, so they're all...
And a payment. Those have all been...
That's what I thought. Yeah. So we're deferring one, two, three, you know, several years would all be due next year. So,
right. So when you deferred last year, you just...
You pushed all of the... All of the back.
Yeah.
Right. So, and just so the people understand, we're not abating it, we're just postponing it.
Mm-hmm.
And then, like you said, maybe that extra time will allow them to figure out what they need to do.
I just caution on the motion that this board can't really technically bind a future board, but I believe next year there's only one selectman's position up for election, so it's unlikely that the makeup of the board will change to
too much.
Have you have a
right.
Different opinion when Kim brings it back.
Just to have it in the record that that's
the
way this
board,
they can absolutely do what
yeah,
anything they want.
Yeah.
I couldn't agree more. So that's my motion. Tony, second.
Sure. All right. Any further discussion? Seeing none? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Simple. That's unanimous. Good. Kim, though, if you could, mark it in the calendar for next year, that would be greatly appreciated. We know that's going to come back again. Thank you. All right. Moving on to the next agenda item, which is agenda item number six, resolution, state bottle bill, which means that we have to read it.
May I?
Yes.
A resolution in support of updating the Massachusetts bottle bill. Whereas the Massachusetts bottle bill, enacted in 1982, has allowed Scituate residents to enjoy a cleaner environment by creating an incentive for users of certain beverage containers to recycle those used containers. And whereas states with deposit laws have higher residential recycling rates of beverage containers than those non-deposit states, and whereas litter decrease in states with bottle bills averaged 70% to 85%, and whereas through the Massachusetts bottle bill, we recycle nearly 80% of containers of deposit containers with only 20% of non-deposit containers, and whereas the Governor of the Commonwealth and members of the Massachusetts Senate and House of Representatives have recognized that the original bottle bill does not take into account those beverages such as bottled water, sports drinks, and teas, whereas the additional bottled water, sports drinks, and teas to the bottle bill will decrease the total volume of municipal solid waste that is needed to be collected, thus saving disposal fees and landfill space, be it resolved that we, the Board of Selectmen of the Town of Scituate, commemorate this 27th anniversary of the implementation of the Massachusetts Bottle Bill. Furthermore, be it resolved that the Town of Scituate goes on the record in supporting programs that encourage residents and visitors to return or recycle all beverage containers and other recyclable materials to fully utilize the currently available recycling programs. Be it further resolved that the Town of Scituate instructs our state representatives and state senators and our governor to support and vote in favor of updating the Massachusetts Container Beverage Law. Signed this third day of May, 2011.
That's very good. Let's face it, that would be great if the legislature would implement that. And many people probably know when you walk around ball fields and around the town, there are a lot of bottles that are discarded in the garbage or thrown strewn all about the place, and frankly, if they were some form of deposit on it, they probably wouldn't be. We noticed that with the bottles themselves. It's a great thing. Hopefully it will be passed. So, all right, moving on to the next agenda item, which is agenda item number seven. That's our report from our town administrator, Tricia.
Just a brief one, but a couple of important items. One is I provided some detailed information on a change of expenditure under the PIG access grant for the server. I don't want to go into too much detail, but it's fairly self-explanatory that we need to replace the main server here that's servicing the hardware for town halls and indirectly school administrative payroll, accounts payable, things like that. I forwarded to the board members today our new IT director's first monthly report. I don't know if you had a chance to read it, and as I indicate here, he's already proved his value in the 5 weeks that he's been here and has already saved, I think, on the order of over $5,000 in a month in streamlining some costs that, frankly, we didn't have the in-house expertise to do. So that's informational, but I just wanted you to know, I think the total cost is around $23,000. Most of that was allocated to, when we approved it last fall, was for an exchange server. And since the exchange server can't happen because of our current main server having a problem, it was like the cart before the horse kind of thing, so we'll be able to do that. But I have to say, it's rather comforting to know that we have someone here that's working to ensure the security and the firewalls are in place for our systems here. So that's great. We have a foreclosure auction coming up on June 3rd. I believe it's the first one we've had in a while, and the first one since I or Jane, our treasurer, has been here. We've actually been working quite diligently with the auctioneer. And we do have another house in the vicinity that we closed on just 2 weeks ago, and we're contemplating whether or not, since it's actually on the same street, whether we'll include that or not. Right now, it looks like we'll probably be able to, but I won't be able to say definitively probably to your next meeting. The caveat to that is, since we just acquired this new house, I had Jane get in touch with John Hallin to see if the Affordable Housing Trust might be interested. That will always be the case when we do a foreclosure. We will convey to them that we have one in our property, we immediately bind it over to insurance, so it's covered. The house that's being foreclosed on the original house is really in very, very poor condition, and frankly, I'll be surprised if we get the lien back on it, in addition to the cost we've had to board it and clean it. This other house, once John takes a look at it, can make a determination if it's an option for the Affordable Housing Trust. And the last thing is the board's approval to sort of change and tweak a little bit the special events project process. We've been doing it under the new system for 2 years now. 90% of those special events go off without a hitch, or they're relatively small events. So what I'm asking is, and also maybe to free up your agendas, is to revert back to the process that was in place before I came, where the town administrator approved those applications after they went through the departmental review. I have that there was one caveat to that. There's actually two. One is, three. If there's a problem with it, it would come back to the board the next year to review. The Knights of Columbus Heritage Day, St. Patty's Day Parade, and the memorial events will still come before this board, because I think it's important not only for you to know what the events are doing, but it's good for folks at home to see as well. And the other caveat would be, which I did not include in my report, is if it's a brand new event and of some scope that we've never seen before, I certainly would want it to come to the board for review, and I neglected to include that. So with your assent, I'd like to implement that process for July 1.
Questions from the board on that?
Thank you. So are you saying that they wouldn't come before, the minor events wouldn't come before, so like the biathlons and stuff like that?
The McCourt Foundation, the duathlon, actually, because there was really no problems with that. Joshua's Run, all those I could just approve after they went through the departmental review.
I think it's a good idea.
The only thing that I think is sometimes it's good, like if we mention the Joshua's Run, will they still come before us and ask for?
No, they wouldn't, but because what you're doing is reviewing everything. Right. But I mean, I could still make a note for you to announce it if you want that.
Maybe another business or something.
Yeah,
just
okay.
So the event is publicized either through the paper or for the.
But like I said, for them to come in when they've had the event and there are no problems with it.
Yep.
I think it can be more efficient both for them and for us.
Okay.
One other question back on the foreclosure issue. You mentioned the affordable housing. What is the law in terms of, does that have to go to auction? Or if the trust wanted to buy it, could they buy it outright? Like, what is the procedure for that?
No, the town would convey it to them.
So
we own the land.
So we own
They're
it.
A town offshoot.
Mm-hmm.
So in essence, they get first. It's like a right of first refusal almost on conservation land. So if they have an interest in it, then we would go to town meeting and just convey it to them, just like we did with that other property. Stockbridge Road land, right?
Right.
Okay, so we control the property. We can either auction it, do whatever, convey it or whatever.
Once we foreclose, we own it. That's why I have to insure it, because if anything happens, it has to be under our binder.
Great. Thank you.
Tricia, thank you very much. That's excellent. Which brings us to other business. Mr. Norton.
Just two things, if I may. Just a reminder, not that anyone hopefully needs a reminder, but Saturday is election day. Some important issues on the ballot. The hours are 7 to
8. 8 till 5.
8 till 5.
At the high school?
At the high school. We usually have a very good turnout. Let's hope that this Saturday is no exception. The other thing I'd just like to, I see Mr. Clarkson down here with some scouts. I wonder if they, if I imagine it's for a badge or a project. I wonder if you can introduce them or they can introduce themselves to the cameras just so we could know they're here.
Why don't we start from my right? Can you just give your name and your rank?
I'm Jake
Foley,
and I'm a scout friend.
Thank you.
Jake, welcome.
I'm Michael Keith, and I'm a life scout.
Michael, welcome.
I'm Rocco Ferreira, and I'm a life scout.
And welcome. I'm John Clarkson. I'm a member, I think I'm still a member of the committee for, this is Troop 7 Boy Scouts of Scituate, Massachusetts.
And is this for an Eagle Scout project?
The citizenship in the community merit badge is one of the Eagle required merit badges.
Just one more, just You know, I followed the, I used to go to most of the Eagle Scout Awards, and I said this more often than not, just about at every award, and I continue to be so impressed by the whole scouting program here in town and the Eagle Scout program. You know, as one reads biographies and autobiographies of people, as we go through life, more often than not, somewhere in that biography or that autobiography is the fact that that person was an Eagle Scout, and it's always jumped out at me, and it's a credit to the whole scouting program and the young men that partake in it, because I have to think at the end of the day that the people who become Eagle Scouts or who go through the program end up just better people. That's all I have to say on that. Thank you.
Thank you.
That's all I have.
Mr. Vignani.
Yeah, just to reiterate, one of the things that Joe brought up is the election on Saturday from 8 to 5 at the high school. But there are some positions that are being appointed or elected, and Sean and myself are up for re-election, as well as assessors and whatnot. But there are two questions on the ballot. The first one is for the override that we've been discussing for a number of years, and then the second one is the citizen's petition, which is
non-binding.
It's non-binding. That's what, so it's the non-binding question about whether overrides should be put a moratorium on them for 3 years. So just so you don't get confused about the two things, the first question, number one, is the override, and that deals with whether you support or don't support the taxes going up. The second one is non-binding, is really just a polling type question to see what the temperature of the people are concerning that issue.
Mr. Harris?
Not tonight, John, thanks.
All right. Gee, I got like four different things, so let me hit them up quickly. Again, I wanted to reiterate what I said to Al Bangert, to Donna Bangert, to all the people who participated this past Saturday and Sunday for Shipshape Day. Phenomenal outpouring. I mean, clearly after the storm and the debris, certainly along the coastline, but not only that, but when you go down the Driftway, if you go down 3A, you could go down streets where all of a sudden you'd see green bags popping up. And I just have to say, I remember seeing a gentleman on Kent Street just picking up, and I just thought to myself, that's a testament to your town, it's a testament to what people do. I realize some people may have been busy, there are other things going on, whether it's children's events, sporting events, personal events, family events, but you know, nonetheless, people get out there and you know, clean up the town, and I have to say, it's phenomenal. And it's a tribute to the town, to the people here in the town offices, and everybody should be proud about that. And you know, if you see stuff, try to pick up. You know, it's great. So I thank people on that front. The other thing I wanted to say was I met on Thursday with the planning board, following up Cole Parkway again, talking about trying to see what the Board of Selectmen would like to do going forward, as well as the planning board. What I thought was only going to be about a 10 or 15 minute meeting ended up being an hour and 15 minutes. And some very good dialogue. What ultimately the upshot was a request that maybe both boards would come up with a charge that we could come up with talking about Cole Parkway, talking about the issues that were raised about 3 weeks ago, long-term parking, short-term parking, business parking, boating parking, trying to expand the land behind Bank of America, which is conservation land, as well as trying to beautify and improve downtown as a whole long-term, in conjunction with walkways, certainly the walkway that's being under construction right now, the first phase on Cole Parkway, which many people see, as well as connecting it with the Harbor Walk to the Lighthouse, to the beaches. Any event, that was an issue we discussed. I said that I would take on the task of creating a charge, bringing it back to the board, and seeing what we can do long term. Again, this is not a year or two or three. This is like a 5 to 10 year issue. So that was the second item I wanted to report back to the board. Third item was this Friday, May 6th, I received a postcard. It's called That Fabled Shore, Historic Images of Scituate. Opening night reception, Friday, May 6th from 6 to 8. It's at the Front Street Art Gallery, and it's going to be images of historic Scituate. So if anybody's interested in going down, I think it would be fascinating. Old photographs, postcards of Scituate, its past, and you know, you see these photographs of people and what they took pride in their town, and and what they thought was beautiful buildings that no longer exist. You get to see what it was like in certain sections. Highly recommended. Again, this is also going to be at the town library from May 23rd through June 12th. But just to let you know, the Front Street Gallery is going to have it from May 6th to the 22nd, and then it's going to go from the 23rd to June 12th. So go to the Front Street Gallery if you're interested. From now until the 22nd, thereafter, go to the town library. That completes the first three things. Briefly, and we're going to be pretty much ending this very quickly, I actually wanted to take this time to say a few points. I've been chairman for a year, and I wanted to take an opportunity now, because next week we're going to have a realignment of the board, and I'm not going to be the chairman of the board. So I wanted to at least have some thoughts and share with people and say it's been a very trying year. When I first came on to the chair, there were issues that I'd looked at I thought were important. The board thought they were important, and we had discussed them. The first issue the board thought was important was the budget. We addressed that issue right off the bat in the month of June, and we continued to address it all the way through the town annual meeting that we had last month. Ultimately, there's going to be a vote this coming weekend. So please go out and vote, whether you agree with it or not, whether you decide to support it or whether you think not. Your voice is very important, so you need to get out and vote. It may be a beautiful day, it may be a rainy day, but you know, this is democracy at its best. So a very important issue for the town. The Board of Selectmen have been diligent in trying to do that which is best. It's fiduciary duty. It's thinking nothing other than what is in the town's best interest. And this is an issue that we just didn't come up with shortly. We addressed it right from the get-go. We also were very cognizant of the issues of seawalls. We've been addressing that issue for over 2 years. Little did we know that that issue was going to come to the forefront right after Christmas, and surely it did. So, you know, I'm very thankful to all support of my board members. The Board of Selectmen have been vigilant in trying to address various issues that are important. But the primary issues were budget. Primary issue was seawalls. We also talked about the Community Preservation Act and trying to see what was going to be important for the town, whether or not we should address issues about reducing or not. The town spoke. We respected it. So I have to say that, you know, it's been a very trying year. It's been a great year in many respects. We've lost a lot of things, people, and people move on. But I have to say that, you know, from my perspective as the chairman of the board, it's been a great experience. But that goes without saying I would not have been able to do what I did with the board, and the board would not be able to do what it does without the support of various people. And the first person I want to recognize tonight is our assistant, our administrative assistant, and that is Kim Donovan. Many people don't realize that she's the individual who actually prepares our document. She's the ones that gets us the information. She's the one that actually we call, we talk to. She's the first person who many of you talk to. When you pick up the phone, you say, you know, I want to talk to the selectman, or you complain, or there's issues. She's the individual who actually takes the phone and tells us. And I actually feel bad, because in many instances I wish that we could kind of take those phone calls, and we do, but she's the first line of defense. So when people call and they get upset, or if they're very happy, which is a good thing, but in many instances it's when people are upset they call and they address it with her. And I have to tell you, I would not have had a successful year without her support. She's always there, she's responsive, and I can't thank her enough for what she's done, for preparing me to address each meeting as we go forward. So I want to thank Kim very much. The other people I'd like to thank, you know, being first year as a chairman, or first time as a chairman, the counsel, the advice, you know, of the old sage, I guess you could say. This person actually is a person I'd always call to try to get input. Whether I agreed with him or not, it's irrelevant. It's just that I could always find some kind of ideas or come up with some insight that I didn't have beforehand. And that was Joe Norton. And I have to say that as the vice chairman, he's been invaluable. He's an invaluable component to this town. He has years of experience, and I have to say I drew on that, certainly during the crisis that we had right after Christmas, trying to figure out what to do in the wake of disorder and chaos when my neighbors and people were being affected by the blizzard and the snowstorm. I have to say he was instrumental in helping this town get through it. So I want to also thank Joe Norton for a great year. The other people I'd like to thank are the department heads. You know, a lot of people don't understand that, you know, yes, we're a part-time board. We don't do this full-time. We do spend an enormous amount of hours, but we all have our own professions. When we get phone calls, we get emails, we talk to people, they're asking us information, and they expect us to know it off the top of our head. And I have to tell you, you know, the first people we call are generally the department heads to try to get the information to figure out, okay, are they correct? Are they wrong? Where are we here? Because you know what? We need to know information in order to be able to tell people, advise people, and inform people. And I have to say that every time I did contacted the department head, as every board member does when they need to, they give us nothing but information that we can use to help people in the town of Scituate. So the department heads are to be commended, and I thank them all. Finally, without going on and on and on, there is one last person that I have to say was instrumental in advising me. You know, I would have to say that she is probably my consigliere as far as giving me all the information I need, whether it's budgetary information, even legal information. And, you know, as you know, I'm a lawyer, but I have to say it's always important to understand municipal law, which I don't in many respects. She was, you know, the first person who was here during the storm. She has been on top of the numbers since June of last year on this budget and trying to figure out what are the numbers going to be. And in many instances, people don't understand that, you know, we don't know what the numbers are going to be, especially with local aid that we get from the state. And day by day, we get this information, trying to work the numbers to try to make it benefit for the town, to keep the departments, to keep people, to keep services. You know, I have to say that this town is very fortunate. We have a phenomenal, and I want to use the word phenomenal, town administrator. And Tricia Vancasey is just the pinnacle of all town administrators. This town does not understand what they have. I do, this board does. And I just want you to understand that, you know, there's a defining moment when I look at people and I deal with people to try to determine or discern their character. I have to tell you right now, all you have to look at is what happened during the storm. Tricia Vancasey was back here the day before expecting a major storm, not realizing it was going to be the type of storm. She was out there overnight throughout the evening into the morning hours, didn't sleep the entire day thereafter here in this building, trying to make sure that we could get services, that we could get the support from the National Guard, as well as the National Grid, who were pretty much absent, as well as other service equipment, departments, towns, bureaucrats from the state. Phenomenal job. You folks don't realize it. I do, because I was here later that day. So I have to tell you, you know, that defines her. You've got a phenomenal town administrator. That's just one aspect. The budget that we've gone through, the culling through this process, the monies, and, you know, trying to save jobs, trying to do is make a dollar go as far as it can. You know, you got the person you want. This is the person you want in this economic crisis. She's the one that we're very fortunate to have. And I have to say, I want to thank her. It's been a great year from that perspective. I've had a support, a base that I can draw from. So that being said, I've been going on for the past 10 minutes, but I just want you to understand, you know, it's not easy being chair, it's not easy being on the Board of Selectmen, but you know, you've got great people in this town, great people in the town side here, and I would be remiss not to say something. And I want you folks, and certainly anybody who's watching this TV, to understand that it's made my job a lot easier, and I thank you all. So, that being said, that's the longest I think I've spoken in other business. I'd like to move on, unless there's other questions, to the next agenda item, which is the minutes.
Will the Board of Selectmen vote to accept the minutes of April 5th, 2011?
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Harris. Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Which brings us to agenda item number 10.
Move to adjourn the Board of Selectmen's vote. Adjourn the meeting at 8:05 p.m.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Harris. Further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Folks, good night, and thank you very much.